Oh, yeah. Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great, they sound even better, and you know me.
Slow down, Andy. Don't hurt yourself. Or you'll go to the blue factory. Slow down, Andy.
Thanks for that advice. Making horse noises over here. That's right, it's your buddy Andy, America's little brother. As always, joined by that guy over there. Look at him go in his special outfit for the day. Look at him, he's ready for...
I'm going to sleep in this as soon as I get home.
Polka dancing his way across the podcast studio. Nick Pollock's in the house.
Good evening, young gentlemen.
Good evening.
Foot's healed. I can kick as high as I used to.
Oh, that's good. I'm glad.
Fully healed, huh?
Well, yeah.
As good as it's going to get.
At this point, yeah.
Nothing's fully healed ever again after a certain point.
Celebrating with your finest basketball shorts wearing tonight.
It's humid out there.
It is.
I'm not putting pants on. Not for this.
Yeah, it's not
needed. For this weather.
And if anyone is listening wearing pants, take them off. No pants. You know why? You own them. We got them.
I think we need a gunslinger. Somebody tough to team this town. I think we need a gunslinger. And there'll be justice all around.
Put your hands together for the breakout star of the podcast medium, that is Chris L. We are Pod of Thunder. We have a great show for you today. I was looking over the notes that we put together each and every week here on the program from the producers and staff. Oh, it's a dynamite program. You're going to love it. Got one of your very favorite songs we're going to be breaking down.
Oh, it's the best.
All your favorite segments coming your way.
So I can't wait for the commercials, frankly.
Yeah, there's going to be at least two sets of them. So a minimum four commercials. This is going to be a good one.
No wonder you're making horse noises.
That's right.
You're going to need it.
It's a lot. That's a lot. Nick, I had a question about your foot because I just... Well, hold on.
Okay.
Didn't you once, many, many, many years ago, drop a guitar on your foot and injure it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And it was like the...
I still have the scar.
The part the strap goes on, sticking out like the little nub.
No, it was the whammy bar.
That was the whammy bar. Yeah. Drove down into your foot.
It went to my foot, yeah.
How horrible.
Not very deep, but yeah.
Blood?
And it was...
Well, if you have a scar, blood, yes.
Yeah, blood. And it was... I don't remember the brand name, but it was like a Toys R Us guitar, and it was called the Terminator. We still have
that black one.
We still have it somewhere.
Yeah.
And it had... a speaker built into it, so it was heavier.
It was heavy.
It was a pretty heavy guitar.
Yeah. Right on the foot.
Yeah, strap gave way.
How long ago did this happen?
Over 30 years ago at this point.
Oh,
I'm thinking.
Okay.
Yeah.
But your foot has never forgiven you.
I still have the scar right there.
Now, how did the whammy bar land on the foot?
It's just pointed down
and it just fell straight down, like if you were holding it playing, it fell straight down with the whammy bar down. Okay.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Onto the foot.
I'll be damned. Well,
live to tell the tale,
I guess. Sorry about that.
Went to a wedding the next day.
A wedding?
Did.
What kind of wedding?
I ended up going to a wedding.
One of those weddings with kids.
I guess so. Where they didn't explicitly tell them no kids.
Yeah. Where the kids just run around and slide on the floor.
Yeah.
Cause trouble.
Yeah, and this was late 80s, early 90s, so.
Yeah.
Did that inhibit your smooth criminal dance performance at the event?
Well, if...
There's some weirdo on saxophone next to you.
If the whammy bar had gone all the way through and into the ground, I could have done smooth criminal all day long.
You could have done it perfectly. The tilt thing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's how he did it, right?
Yeah.
Is that how he did it? His shoe was nailed to the...
I think there was a thing that the shoe fit onto the stage.
I think there was like a stud.
Yeah.
And like the shoe had a circular hole in the heel or something.
Oh, that requires some precision.
It does.
Choreography.
Yeah, you got to be on your spot.
Good thing he wasn't sharing the bill with Pavarotti. I heard that random thing that he used to... take a hammer every time he would perform and walk the stage before the performance and find a loose nail and rip it out.
What?
That was his superstition, I guess.
He had to rip a nail out of the stage.
He had to rip a nail out of the stage.
Why don't you just pound it back in?
That's what I was thinking you were going to say. I don't know. I thought you were going to say, like, oh, he would find a loose nail, then yell at someone about the loose nail being a hazard.
No, he'd rip it out. So if he was going on with Michael Jackson, he might have ripped that stud out.
Yeah.
Could have been embarrassing.
That's why they were never a double bill.
It's the only reason.
Yeah.
So...
Mm-hmm. You know, last week, as of our recording date right now, last week there was a birthday of a performer that was featured on a recent episode.
I hope
you know where I'm going. If not, then I'm in trouble.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah, I'm not following it.
Joey Tempest's birthday. I hope Andy's ready.
I have no idea what you're talking
about. Oh, great. We'll come back to it.
Yeah, I guess so. I don't know what you're... Oh, no, I think I know what you're talking about. Anyway.
We'll come back to it.
I'm sorry.
Just a little allusion to what's coming.
I didn't know.
Is it your Cherokee performance?
No, Andy, I think... Or I don't know if I have it or Andy has that, but...
The Cherokee thing?
Yeah.
I've got the tape.
Oh, Andy has the tape.
No. The videotape?
Yeah.
People need to see that.
Oh, man.
I know. We gotta digitize that.
I was culturally misappropriating makeup on my face.
Well, you thought you were Native American still, so it was allowed.
I still am. I don't know about you.
I don't know how I lost it.
That was around the time when you impaled your foot with a whammy bar, right?
That would have been, I think, just a little before it, because I had this little... just plastic toy guitar for that performance. But anyway.
Well, but I mean, you were close to age.
I get
the two incidents.
It was a few years.
A few years.
Yeah, this was like second grade. The thing went into my foot probably fourth grade.
Oh, okay. All right.
So it was Joey Tempest's birthday of Europe.
Yeah.
He had one of those... someone threw him a party where he didn't know there was going to be a party.
Okay.
And then he walked in and he was unaware that a party was being thrown for him.
It happens.
I forget what they call that, but we have a clip.
Okay.
Ninja surprise!
What the hell is that?
So that came from... I tried to make that joke in our group text message with Jericho about it being Tempest's birthday. And instead of Ninja Survive, they had a Ninja Surprise Party. Yeah. It got
zero?
The joke fell on the ground into an unmarked grave.
Well,
immediately.
Also did the clip.
But the clip was made with that...
But here's the thing.
I'm doubling down and just going out in a blaze of glory.
Whoever gets it is laughing right now.
is there a Europe song? Ninja something?
Ninja Survive.
Or Survive.
Oh, yeah. I had no idea.
See, I didn't either. Yeah.
That's your...
Well, if you're the
way
one...
Way in the weeds with Europe.
If you're the
casual
one,
fan is...
If you're the
it.
One guy who enjoyed it, send me a message.
Play it again now that I know what it means. Yeah. I might be able to appreciate it.
Ninja surprise!
There's a crowd yelling in the back.
Surprise!
Yeah.
I'll see you guys later.
Yeah, your work is done here. I'm sure there's a single-digit amount of people really enjoying themselves right now. And I'm happy for
them. I guarantee our friend Jared...
He
is popping his cork right now over that clip.
That's good.
Well, so if one person enjoyed, I enjoyed it after it was explained.
I didn't understand it either.
I didn't know what it meant.
And when you were
and it was made out of spite.
Yeah.
Want that to be clear.
Yeah,
that's respectable.
Look, not every joke is going to hit the bullseye. You never know.
And you know, if it doesn't work on three people over here, it might work on three people over
there.
That's
true. So. But.
And you tried it on the same two guys that didn't get first time.
Yeah, so he clearly he thought Jericho was the problem, and he was wrong.
Yeah, no.
Just too deep in the weeds with your knowledge.
It's just helping me deduce exactly what went wrong.
Yeah.
Well, there's only one way to find out.
But something something that didn't go wrong this week.
What is it?
Big treat, big treat, big treat.
I got to tell you, I don't want to say I'm disappointed. Yeah, that's the wrong word. But this is not as decadent as what you usually bring to the show.
It's not.
This appears to be some type of
sponge cake.
Yeah, I was going to say angel food cake. What is it?
It's not as spongy as that. It's a little denser, more dense, whatever the proper way to say it is.
Is this health food?
It's an orange olive oil cake.
Orange olive oil.
Yeah, it's pretty good, actually. My wife found a recipe, and she said, you should make this. So I gave it a try.
I had cookies that were orange. I forgot what spices, and olive oil was in it too, and it was really good.
It's like I don't know. I guess instead of the butter, it's just like a what was it, 3/4 cup of olive oil. It's a lot of olive
oil.
Damn. Yeah.
Jeez.
So
is it gonna be rich or?
No, not terribly. It's
so airy and light.
Well, Nick made a cake the size of a swimming pool. So
That would make it a large orange olive oil cake.
There you go.
Which is good.
That's good.
Which is what if you're going to have an orange, you might as well have a large orange.
Yeah. No one wants
it's
a small
the only
orange.
Way to go.
No.
9-inch diameter orange. So.
There you go.
Yeah.
Exactly what we need for the last week of Pot of Thunder month.
A certain month.
Almost hate to see it go,
but I was about to say it's bittersweet because you hate to see it go, but September is on the horizon.
It's exciting.
And we got a delivery today.
We did?
Yeah.
I'll be damned. Look at that. Look at us. Well,
it's from our buddy Niels Johnson.
We
treated to the Fozzie experience and Aurora last time. Actually, I should say Fozzie treated him to the experience. We didn't pay for shit. But he sent this out. Just asked for is the address still good to send stuff? And it was here in a day. It's an Amazon Prime envelope. So that means it was drop shipped.
It looks
must be
like
a new item.
Looks like a DVD.
Well, he did. He did say, "I hope one of you has a Blu-ray player."
Okay.
So, here we go. The Wild Life, the movie he referenced, the Fast Times at Ridgemont High-esque film that I've never seen. So
I've never even heard of it.
Watching. I've never seen it either.
Chris Penn is the lead.
Chris Penn. You got Randy Quaid in it, which is a must see for Nick. Rick Moranis is in it.
Oh,
I didn't
know
that. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Neil.
Cool. Yeah. I'll be watching this. Assuming my Blu-ray player still works. It's been forever since I watched anything on it. But, yeah, cool. Gotta love that. A guy makes a movie recommendation and sends you the movie.
Make sure that you see it.
That is pretty great.
Deluxe treatment.
Thank you, Neil.
Leah Thompson. Eric Stoltz. The original Back to the Future stars.
Yeah. How about that?
How about it?
What's the year on that?
84.
So right before Back to the Future. This went so well that they said, Spielberg said, give me more of
those guys. And then I want all of them.
And then Zemeckis said,
I don't think this is working.
The girl.
4 weeks or something? I forgot how long it was.
Moranis' hair looks hilarious on the back here.
Can't break up the band. Let me see. Oh, yeah.
That's like that Richie Valens picture you sent me the other day.
The five-head Richie Valens painting that that we've decided the Richie Valens group is the most entertaining, probably unintentionally entertaining,
for sure,
group on all of Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, cool. Thanks, Neil. Appreciate it. Yeah. I'll be watching this. So, the late, great Chris Penn, by the way.
Yeah. Died young, right? Yeah. 40-something?
I think so. Something like that.
But he's in Corky Romano and I don't know what
that
else.
That was his peak.
Reservoir Dogs, of course.
But I think
he was working on his craft, learning his craft, doing Reservoir Dogs. The pinnacle was Corky Romano.
Organized crime was his specialty, apparently.
Yeah, that's true. All right, well, whose turn is it?
I'll do it.
All right.
Here I come.
All right, cake boy. Come over here.
Yeah, olive oil, large orange.
All right.
Okay, I'm going to get queued up for you know what, so.
I forgot we had that.
What do you mean you forgot we had that?
I didn't even know that was a part of the show. We haven't recorded it in 10 days.
What do you think of the cake? I see you took a nibble.
That's very good.
Can you taste the orange?
I could taste the orange, but also what I enjoy the most is that there was like a granular texture to it that I liked. That's good stuff. All right, pull it.
Stand by. Let's go over to the Bozo Pewter.
In the year 3378. No Pope stuff, but Nick is looking at the list.
Oh, it's there.
It's right here.
While you're quick. Ooh, are there any comments?
There you go. These two.
No.
No,
I don't think so.
Not happening.
No, I appreciate, and there were two people who submitted it, but yeah. I just don't know.
I probably would have ran with it.
You think so?
I'm not saying you should have, but I think I would have.
You know what? All right.
But Bushwick, I'm not trying to change it.
No, you know what? I'll hold on to it.
Okay. All right. Well, then
I'm not going to go with it immediately, though.
Let's give it another.
Oh, it's in the hopper. Okay.
Yeah.
You're going to hopper it. Okay. Let's give it another pull. The year 1750.
I can't imagine a scenario where I would go with this.
All right, well, I'm going to Bushwick the song, but we'll see about the other thing. Move along to the next trick.
You said 1750?
That's right.
All right. See what we got. Mm. Go do your thing while I'm looking.
Okay. Pull it? Or no? We don't know if we have it. You mean continue with the next one?
Or do more?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, okay. All right, Nick, give it another pull, would you?
Yeah.
That's going to be way down here. The year 4453. Our only hope is 1750. Anything? Any thoughts here, Nick?
Thoughts here? No, I don't think so.
That's out.
No, sorry.
All right. Move along to the next trick.
All right, well. I guess by default we go with the first one,
really?
Right?
Really? Yeah, I guess we have to, unless you had something special top of mind.
I might.
Well.
And it's on the list.
Well, why don't you head over there and think about it?
I think I'll go with the one that I have in mind.
Okay.
It's on the list.
Okay. All right. Well, you think about... Oh, you got your mind made up.
I think so. I think I'm going to go rogue a little bit.
Trying to buy time here.
But it's still a listener submission song.
Okay.
So it's not exactly... You know, I'm not going with... something that has no listener participation whatsoever.
Yeah.
So
that's fair.
Let's see here.
Mm-hmm. Well, Nick.
Well, hit it. I got something here.
Abe Moose Papa. Time for Pope stuff. Yeah, that Pope stuff. Here's some Pope stuff. Time for Pope stuff.
Okay. All right, so Benedict the 14th. Original name, Prospero Lambertini.
That's my guy.
He was the Pope from 1740 to 1758.
And I,
I actually have a
tidbit about him off the top of my head.
All right, let's hear it.
He put out some sort of
mixtape.
Mixtape. He
diss track.
Pronounced. He got the word out. I don't know what they call it technically, but he assured everybody back then in the 1700s, communication was obviously very slow, and he put to rest the rumor that vampires existed. He assured everybody there's no such thing as vampires. There was a big fear of them. People thought they were real.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'll be damned.
He proclaimed, I guess, a proclamation might have been what I was trying to think of.
Wow.
That's true.
Despite his bullshit, 150 years later, they were making vampire movies out the wazoo. So Bela Lugosi gave the big middle finger to Pope Benedict XIV, a.k.a. the fun sucker.
Chris will not be with vampires.
Mm-mm.
Don't mess with his vampires,
well,
people.
Do we really need somebody just
back
saying
then,
that vampires don't exist?
Back then, well, yes.
I'm assuming it was an issue.
But why? What would make it an issue? It's people were fascinated by vampires by the same reason they are today. They like to be scared. They get a rush from it.
Well, I'm guessing the difference was people thought it was real. And they were probably—is it like how witches were, where you had to,
yeah, probably
murder them? Were people accusing each other of being vampires and then beating them to death?
It wasn't just a group of metrosexuals drinking safe blood at a meeting or something. This was
a real
legit
deal. Yeah, there's fear.
People probably lived in the woods. They thought, oh my gosh, there's vampires everywhere around me.
Yeah. Better kill that guy. Looks like a vampire.
Well, it might have happened.
Yep.
Yeah. I'll just read this quick paragraph about him. Benedict was an active scholar all his life, founding several learned societies and laying the groundwork for the present Vatican Museum.
Okay.
A lively wit, he corresponded with many of the great men of his age, including Voltaire.
Wow.
Who dedicated his tragedy Muhammad to him.
Okay.
Okay. There you go.
There's ain't that Pope stuff.
Mm. That sure was.
Many learned societies he founded. That's a great thing to be said about you.
It is.
It is, yeah.
If I drove by a learned society, I would probably want that in my obituary.
Mm-hmm.
If I ever just happen to see one.
That's the closest you would come to.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
Let alone founding...
I mean, Pot of Thunder, I guess, could be considered a learned society.
I was just about to say that.
Yes, sir.
And who knows how many other societies we've inspired to rise up and become a learned society. So yeah. I think we can feel good about that.
All right. Okay, well,
that's
Nick...
That's one of the things we try to do with Pope stuff, is teach people... Give people some educational value.
Yeah.
So, there you go. We're not just a podcast. We're a learned society as of today.
I like that. Going forward. Yeah, I do a learned society broadcast once a week.
I like it.
People ask what you do.
Yeah. but that's just, you know, recreation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've founded several learned societies. So yeah,
that's
what I've done. You know,
I hate to say this. That's one of my biggest pet peeves, though, when you meet someone for the first time and they're like, so what do you do?
Yeah.
I'm just going to start saying that. Well, yeah. I've founded several learned societies.
And just don't elaborate. Either they'll shut up out of utter confusion, or they'll ask you a follow-up question and just, like, ignore it.
Well, yeah. But that's when you appeal to their sense of self-esteem or vanity even and say, well, what do you do?
Yeah.
Let's talk about you.
Yeah.
Exactly. Enough about me.
I founded several learned societies, but
enough about me.
I'd like to know what.
What have you done?
What are you up to?
I'm gonna take out a pen and paper.
What lights your fire right now? Andy had the best answer ever to that years and years ago. When someone asks you what you do.
I don't remember this.
Well, now he has a better one, but go.
And
on.
then I kind of used it. One time,
okay,
and people thought it was true.
what is it?
Andy, I don't know if he ever did it or he just told me he would do it, but he said if somebody ever asked me that, I'm just going to say I'm a scientist.
Oh, okay,
and that's it. Just no,
no.
So I said that one time, and then I had to actually keep going because I remember Andy saying that. So I for whatever reason, the movie Men at Work came to mind.
The Charlie Sheen, Emilio Estevez,
and there's a scene in there where they lie about being phrenologists.
Okay,
and so that's what I said I was.
That's kidneys?
No, they analyze the bumps on people's heads.
What?
Like if there's a little. That's from the movie.
Okay,
and it's a real thing. I'm pretty sure. So that's what I said, and people thought it was real, and so I kind of made a fool of myself because I.
You continued.
I had to keep going because they were looking at me.
That's the thing. You don't have to. You flip it around and say, "That's not important." What do you do?
Say this is a party. Let's talk about something. Yeah.
Science has no place here.
Yeah,
exactly. I could talk your ear off about phrenology, but really, what do you do? Yeah.
But really, where's the toilet?
As soon as we're done recording, I'm going to change my LinkedIn subhead to founder of several learned societies.
Might as well.
It's no less bullshit than anything else on that site.
Yeah, that's true.
Bullshit narcissism. I'm doing it.
Do it.
Why not?
Yeah.
Who's going to question it? There's no confrontation on LinkedIn. That's not what it's for.
It's rare.
It's thumbs up from everybody.
Self puffery is all it is, and just zero value whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Well, zero value is true. There's nothing good about it.
Let's stop talking about it because it's all I'm saying is. When you wake up tomorrow, my subhead on there will be founder of several learned societies, and that's it.
A learned society's favorite podcast on Twitter.
Well, there you go.
several learned society's favorite podcast.
The founder of several learned society's favorite podcast. Let's see if that fits in the
is there a character limit?
There is.
Okay. All right.
Well, I picked the song. It's on the list. It's one that I made a mental note of a while back that if I ever came in this position, found myself in this position, I would do this.
So you're not going with the first one?
No. I don't know. Okay.
Don't want to risk that.
It's a little risky.
That's fine. I get it.
I want to go with an artist who very likely has not founded any learned societies.
Mm. That's good. It's a good first step.
Well, it's only a select few on the planet have ever done that. The three people in this room and Pope Benedict the 14th, and that's about it. That's all I can think of.
Yeah, it's a tight-knit group. He'd be here now if it wasn't for, you know,
the fact
that it was 300 years ago.
He was talking to Voltaire. He would have corresponded with us.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And of course, as we know, his nickname would have been Eggs in this in this social circle. So, you know, it's how clever we are. We got Taco Bell in England and Eggs Benedict
over in Rome.
Yep. So,
all right, Nick, are you ready?
Oh, I am, but I don't know if anybody else is.
All right, well, let's turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold, This one's called
The Lumberjack.
Oh God.
Off of
Jackyl.
Oh my. Shit.
By the band
A Jackyl.
Oh, 30 years
ago this album came out. August 11th, 1992.
Oh, well, there you go. That's kind of timely.
Hulk Hogan's birthday. What a present.
Yeah, well,
it's true.
I'm sure he was in some lumberjack matches.
Yeah, there you go.
So it
ties Hulk
in.
Hogan's birthday and the first Jackyl album came out. What a day for white trash people everywhere.
You know who? The other reason I remember that birthday, Flying Aaron's birthday.
Oh well,
same birthday as Hulk Hogan. That's how I knew it.
And
in the Jackyl.
Same day as the release of the debut self-titled Jackyl album.
Oh, I'm looking at this right now. I forgot about the last song.
Yeah.
What is the last song? I don't think I ever knew it.
Track 11 of 11, She Loves My Cock.
Oh, that's right. I've heard the title.
Now, in spite of that, this is a good album. I dare say a great hard rock album.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Never delved into Jackyl.
Our brother Jay got it around the time.
You even have to say it. I mean,
well, he did. He liked, I believe, what "I Stand Alone" might have been the first single, and I remember, I think it was right after that song he went out and got it. And there are a lot. They had a string of hits off this album in particular. That was
down on me. On this.
Yeah. When Will It Rain? I Stand
ass
Alone.
In 92,
I think
huh?
"Dirty Little Mind" was a single.
Yeah,
I mean,
She Loves My Cock, of course, got some traction. I think I've never heard it.
I remember that song. I remember the whole album pretty much.
Wow,
Brain Drain's a great one. I don't know if it was ever a single, but that's a great one.
Where are these guys from? Atlanta or something.
That's a good question. These guys are. They were. Come on now, don't do
it's
this.
Got
to
be
me.
Georgia.
You think
so? Somewhere where they're. White trash
You're
people.
Kennesaw, Georgia.
There you go. I probably knew that and kind of wasn't sure if I was remembering correctly.
Yep.
They seem like Georgia guys.
What are you saying, Andy?
Saying a bunch of pieces of shit down there.
Okay.
Who make great albums, apparently. Mm-hmm.
So you would classify this as a great album.
I would say so, yeah. A lot of really good songs on this album.
Yeah, I've never delved into Jackyl, so I'm not going to question that.
I recommend it. I haven't followed them through the years. I know that they have a reputation as like a really hardworking band, still releasing, still touring, and all that.
Yeah, they're on the circuit, the Sturgis rallies, all the Rocklahomas, things of that nature.
But then they're just around at small clubs constantly.
Yeah.
Like they're. They do
well,
the,
what else are they going to do? It's their job.
Yeah.
They're workhorses.
Yeah. Go to work.
People are showing up. Why not? You know?
Yep.
Well, it's a platinum album.
Platinum album.
Yeah.
Wow.
In the United States.
And to get to have a platinum album in that time frame, I mean, that was... 92 was still on the cusp where you still had some of that, you know... holdover from the 80s, but that was just going away quickly.
Well, and the producer was really on a roll.
Okay.
Brendan O'Brien.
Ooh.
Oh yeah.
I mean, he was in his
hand in everything.
He was in the midst of the whole STP thing going on. The 92 was sort of, they were in a transitional period sonically.
What was that between the first two albums for
STP? The first one I think was 90.
Was that 91?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, he was on fire, I'd say, or just about to be. But this Jackyl album is good.
Yeah.
I don't know how many of our listeners are going to agree with me, but I always liked it.
I think it's a great pick for an episode.
Oh yeah,
I'm excited about that.
I mean, just for the very beginning of the song.
Mm-hmm.
Just it's completely unprecedented, as far as I know.
Well,
I
was going
to
say
music.
How nobody had thought of that. Before he did it,
I mean, it's kind of, when did For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge come out? With the
91
Eddie Van Halen with the power tool, Jesse James Dupri kicked it up a couple notches.
I'm putting it down as 91, but
you're probably right. It's before this album.
Paul Gilbert was doing power drill stuff with Racer X and Mr. Big before any of that. Yeah. So he was a real pioneer. But when you're busting out a chainsaw, is next level. Next level stuff. And it wasn't one of those electric ones either. It was full gas powered.
Yeah.
Chainsaw.
Yeah, and I mean, it's not like it didn't have the teeth on it or anything.
Yeah, he's cutting stuff right. up with
he's
it.
He's cutting it.
That's got to be an every gig thing to this day, right?
You can't not play the lumberjack if you're Jackyl.
Yeah.
And then, as we'll get into, but I'm sure they used an actual gas-powered chainsaw in the studio, put a microphone on it.
I'm assuming the fumes hung out for a little while.
Yeah. Yeah, that's an interesting thing. You don't want to kill everyone in the entire
Make
studio.
Make it quick.
But...
You only have one take. Get it right. Yeah, that's true.
Carbon monoxide poisoning.
It was two guys who could do it on the first take. Daryl Hall, Jesse James Dupree. Two guys who could just get in there and do it on the first take.
Yep, no issues. Yeah, okay. Wow. I'm excited.
Now, you said somebody submitted it. Are there comments?
I'm pretty sure at least one person submitted it. And if not, we're not going back on it at this point. But
yeah,
I'm pretty sure I saw it on there.
Who's the crazy maniac who put this on here? Oh, Evan Lockwood.
Thank you, Evan.
Evan says, currently still catching up on episodes on 380 right now. And heard that this song wasn't on the list. We must have discussed that. That's funny. I don't remember that.
There was an old production piece, a sound clip, with the beginning of this song. I don't even remember what it was.
Was it like...
It fell flatter than the one...
Fake the Leaves? Or Rake the Leaves?
No, that one actually somehow succeeded, but... it went over worse than the Ninja Surprise did.
Do you remember what it was? You don't remember?
No, I just remember that it incorporated the beginning of this song.
Okay. I really hope someone other than me added this after hearing that, because this song fucking rules. Love a sax solo. How about a goddamn chainsaw? There you go. All right. Well,
Evan, this is for you, and unfortunately, nobody else joined you, I don't think. I don't know what's wrong with all you people.
The listeners... judgment is questionable. First of all, because they're listeners of the show, but also some of the shit that's on the list and some of the stuff that's not is just makes you wonder about people.
Well,
have you ever seen their Woodstock 94 performance?
I just recently was watching it.
I didn't even know it was a thing till our friend Aaron Green told me about
it. He had like a 40-pound vest on.
Of what?
Is it some kind of metallic thing? And
like a bulletproof
like
vest?
A big Uncle Sam hat or something like that.
Oh, man. I have to watch. I've not seen it.
So I put it on. It's on YouTube. Mm-hmm. I put it on. I'm watching it. During the first song, I forget what the song was. They're showing the crowd. The crowd's moving and everything. And I don't remember seeing this in the footage of other bands.
Yeah.
Completely 100% naked woman crowd surfing in front of the stage, just like a few rows deep. And it's like, well, it's a Jackyl show.
I guess that's it. And that had to be like a Friday afternoon.
It was daytime,
right?
Yeah.
They're not headlining. But yeah, I didn't even realize they performed there. So,
yeah.
Interesting.
No, they were, again.
I feel like they didn't fit in with that.
No, but that's festival. That's what's great about it. Is this was the height of the alternative stuff, and you had like sort of AC/DC style southern rock amalgamation.
Yeah,
and it took off. It's like Aerosmith had a big record during the whole grunge thing.
Yeah,
Van Halen did all right. That's true. There was still some diversity in rock music. It wasn't like grunge came in and just that was
nothing
all
else
that there
existed.
Was. Yeah, there,
yeah.
Yeah, there were still bands doing really well with big hits.
Yeah.
Who weren't identified as such.
Yeah. No, that's fair. It was right on the cusp there.
All right. Well, I think it's time for a commercial.
Oh, good.
We'll be right back with the Lumberjack.
So it's, I'm smiling already. Like the very beginning, I don't think I ever noticed it. There's a little grunt, like he's got to pull the.
He's pulling it. Yeah.
I hate those, by the way. Yeah. I've almost broken my finger. I don't know how many times on lawnmowers with the pulls, the whatever.
What are you doing with your fingers?
The rip cord, whatever you call it. No, it'll just. I pull it too far and it snaps back.
Why are your arms so long?
My wife told me that the other day too. It's true.
I don't even investigate that any further.
No,
I don't even want to know.
No, I was told my arms are a little longer than normal people. Yeah,
I've heard that from people before, too. That might be a family trait. A guy I worked with used to make fun of me and say that.
Wow.
He's like, your sweaters are too short. Your arms are too long. I'm like, okay.
Man.
Whatever, dude. Talk your about, sleeves and your sweaters.
That's a prescription for a trip to HR right there.
It is.
Make fun of my arms.
Yeah. Can't have it. Arm shaming.
Yeah. But I did have my pants around my ankles at the time. So.
Okay, you didn't even have to bend at the waist to do it.
No,
with those arms.
No,
and his rip cord snapped back accordingly. So, but yeah, no. If I mean that would make sense if you have a longer arm and you pull the cord further than it's supposed to go, it's gonna snap back. That's what it's supposed to do.
Yeah, thought I broke a finger a few times.
It's dangerous.
But you gotta love. That the chainsaw, it actually works, mm-hmm. like, as though he's playing a certain note.
Right.
It actually works with the music, with the background music, which is just a very stock blues sort of a riff.
Yeah, rock blues thing. Yeah.
But with a chainsaw. And that, ha-ha.
Yeah. Like, he's so happy to start it up, you know? It's like when you get the lawnmower out for the first time in the spring and you're not sure if it's going to start up. When it does, you're just like, ha-ha, yes. You don't have to deal with getting this thing fixed. I can just go about my business.
See, and already in this song, you know, okay, the front man is... Even if you've never heard this band, you hear this much of it, you're like, okay, we're getting a larger-than-life... personality for a front man.
Of Absolutely. Course.
And that's what should accompany this type of music.
How did he do that?
Guy took it down an octave.
How did he do that with his chainsaw?
Hey, who else do you know that's famous for playing the chainsaw? Nobody.
That's it.
He's the Pavarotti of chainsaw players. You know? Instead of pulling out a loose nail, he takes a chainsaw to the board and cuts it to shreds in the venues where he plays.
Mm-hmm. Now we're going to get some of his vocal.
The dulcet tones of Jesse James Dupree.
There it is. Climb on in the backwoods of a two-bit-no-a town. Fiving on some rock and roll, baby, so you mothers can boogie down. I ain't whistling Dixie. No, I'm a rebel with a groove. This guy's great.
Yeah,
Let's face it.
He's high in the mix, huh? That vocal
don't bury a voice like Jesse James Dupree.
I know, but I feel like that's like the predominant thing you're hearing here.
Well, like, of course, you got a guy like him, you don't bury it in the mix. You lead with your strength.
I guess so.
I mean, when you've got a guy in a debut album for a band, and let's face it, personality-wise and vocally, could be an AC/DC.
Yeah.
Sure, and you heard the song that Brian Johnson did they did together, "Locked and Loaded."
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. The voices just blend together beautifully.
I mean, let's face it, he's a rock and roll front man,
of course,
and he's got the voice.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, you bank on this guy when you've got
and to invoke the name of our buddy Jack Russell, who we revere on this program. You know, he's like a Jack Russell with like Jack Russell on steroids.
Yeah,
like a lot more conviction and energy than Jack, but it's got that element to the voice.
And a ton of personality in the voice with the sort of shakiness toward the end of the lines.
Yeah.
A little
He's
bit
got a great style.
A unique sort of a spin on it.
While around the world they go round and round, when they dig on my new stainless steel sail. Oh yeah.
The audacity.
I don't even know what he's saying.
When okay. they, I think it's around the world they go round and round when they dig on my new stainless steel sound. I always thought oh, okay. it was.
All right.
The audacity. You mm-hmm. gotta love it.
Yeah. I'm looking up the lyrics now just so we have it.
Just, I mean, he's playing a chainsaw as an instrument, and then he's singing about it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He's
mm-hmm.
singing about how he's playing a chainsaw.
Well, why wouldn't you?
Exactly.
That's the question.
You want it to be, you want to hit people over the head with it. No subtlety.
Yeah, he's not like us that when we say we founded learned societies, then we say nothing else about it. He comes in with a lumberjack, or a chainsaw. You're like, that's cool. Now I want to hear you play it. And he proceeds to go and play it.
Yeah.
And then he proceeds to talk about playing. He's not an asshole like us who just makes shit up and then just leaves it on the table. He lays it all out there. Brings the chainsaw, plays the chainsaw, talks about playing the chainsaw. I mean,
sings
why wouldn't
it.
You do
yeah.
it?
Yep.
I say I'm a lumberjack, baby, and I'm gonna cut you down to size. I'm a lumberjack, baby, and you're the one that gets my prize.
I don't think I know that line, that one that he did the little stutter start there.
Okay, I'll tell you what he said. Mm-hmm. And you're the one that gets my prize.
Oh boy.
Yep.
Gene Simmons-esque lyric there.
It is, yeah. Gonna cut you down to size. You're the one that gets my prize.
I like the one who gets my prize. It's great the way he performed it.
Mm-hmm.
Not a great line. But the I'm gonna cut you down to size.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great line.
That is.
He's singing about being a lumberjack.
He says I'm a lumberjack now, baby. Huh?
it's too bad there's no reference to you better have hotcakes ready for me. That's the one thing missing from this song, I think.
Some kind of
he could have used
Bunyan
that
reference.
He could about a blue bull or something.
Blue ox.
Or blue ox, that's what it was.
Yeah.
When you hear my motor running, you know I surely be copying a rise. Ah, so I'm gonna crank it up, go down there, chicken.
Awesome.
That is great.
Now,
it's incredible.
It's better than any harp solo or harmonica solo
but
you'd hear.
It had that dirty saxophone sound at times, too.
Mm-hmm. That part where it was
and
like...
Had like and the quality of a good harp player, you know?
Yeah.
Like the great Kim Wilson, of course.
Yes.
But, you know, there's nothing worse than... If you're at open jam and there's some asshole comes with a harmonica or a mouth harp, it's like, okay, this is gonna suck. You know? And so that would be fun. Show up to your next open jam with a chainsaw.
Yeah.
You're like, hey, can I jam with you? You just fucking turn it on and go Jesse James Dupree on the room.
Now, I noticed
kill everyone with carbon monoxide.
Yeah,
boys,
that's the thing.
Running a gas engine inside.
Got to be an outdoor show.
Mm-hmm.
That's you know I noticed while we were listening to that, and that's a legit chainsaw solo.
Mm-hmm.
Like
yeah,
it's gone. It went. We were all kind of like smiling at the beginning, And then we kind of stopped, and we were like digging it, enjoying it.
He got all technical.
Yeah, and it did
some trickery, some flash playing.
It went from like novelty to being pretty impressive.
Yeah,
pretty musical and pretty impressive, and really effective.
Yeah, there's a lot that I don't know about chainsaws, so
I don't know how you would do this.
I'm befuddled as to how you get it to drop to those lower notes.
I don't know.
How is he doing that?
That's the thing.
It's
all about working the throttle, but I didn't think you could throttle up and down that quickly.
Yeah, right.
I don't know if there's studio trickery from Mr. O'Brien, or if Dupree is just simply a virtuoso on the chainsaw.
I wonder if it's got something to do with the choke. He's probably adjusting the choke. He's one with the instrument at this point.
Yeah, yes, exactly.
Has he switched over to an electric chainsaw?
Yeah.
Get with the times.
It was like when Bob Dylan did that.
Yeah.
All the other lumberjacks were furious for a while, and then it caught on.
People walked out when they saw an extension cord coming out to the chainsaw, yelling Judas at the stage, very Dylan-esque. See, you know, who knew Jesse James Dupree had so much in common with Bob Dylan? Again, this is the learned society aspect of this program.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A thinking man's podcast.
Yeah, people saw Black and Decker on the chainsaw, and they're like, "Okay, I'm not having this. It's got to be style or nothing."
Is that a battery?
Yeah.
Is that a battery I see?
Yeah. Even worse now is the rechargeable.
Yeah.
Chainsaw. No, that's not going to cut it.
Yeah, you're not going to get the power.
I need to see a gas can somewhere on the stage. And there can't be any cords or visible batteries, otherwise it's a ripoff. I want my money back.
Yeah, and you need it to smell. If you can't smell,
I want to see some exhaust coming out of it. You know, you're probably running the gas oil mixture, so you're going to get some clouds of exhaust from that.
Yeah.
I need to see it, otherwise I'm walking out. I need my money back.
Does he cut stuff up? Is that part of the act?
I think he cut a chair in half,
like
or a stool.
Like a bar stool, I think, is kind of his thing. I don't know if it still is, but...
I remember on one of those VH1 shows, he let Eddie Trunk cut the stool in half on stage.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. See, now, if we had Jesse James Dupree on the show, I would ask him the same question I asked Todd Kearns. Is it hard to sing and play the chainsaw at the same time?
Yeah.
When you're doing these complex chainsaw lines and you're singing on top of it, is that a tough thing to do?
Where does he hold it? Up and up over his head?
You'd think so, because it's got to be a hazard.
This is real rock and roll danger here.
Yeah, if it's too low, you know... The guitar player might do that thing where he backs into you and sing on the same mic as you.
there's no Steven Tyler, Joe Perry sort of vocal harmonies going on when Jesse James
everyone's on the complete other side of the stage, just looking at him, not enjoying what they're doing at all, not into their performance,
stay away from Jesse during the lumberjack.
Does he put cones down?
You know, a construction motif wouldn't be bad.
Does he have one of those like scissor gates that they open at Home Depot when they close an aisle to get something off the top?
That reminded me of a chainsaw story, but I think I told it already. The one where I went to get a Christmas tree at Home Depot, and there was nobody working the chainsaw to cut the end off.
Oh, that's right.
And then some guy. We were asking for a half hour or so. Nobody came. Oh, yeah, we'll send somebody. Some maniac hops behind the counter, starts cutting everybody's customer.
Just I'll do
grabs
it.
The chainsaw. Then they find out. Then they send somebody.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
They were okay with making you wait, but once there's a potential lawsuit. Yeah.
So the guy,
got a cowboy.
The end
lumberjack.
Of a scarf dangling into that blade. Then suddenly you got, yeah, exactly, a huge lawsuit. So it's just absolute anarchy at Home Depot.
What do they do? Cut a couple inches off the bottom?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just yeah. so the water will absorb into it.
Right.
Okay. Interesting. All right, let's keep going.
This must be what it sounds like in Andy's work chair. He's always texting me saying he's letting him fly in his work chair.
A lot of fiber in my breakfast. Yeah. It's pretty accurate, Nick. Thanks for sharing with everyone.
That's an ending right there.
I remember that. Fucking weirdos.
Like a feral cat running exactly. around the street.
I could. That whole last sequence is just like, I could totally see your brother Jay just wanting to run through a wall after listening to that. It's just his kind of music.
That was one of those AC/DC live type endings where it just kept like the ending was a minute long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, they were bringing that's live energy and showmanship brought to the studio. Mm-hmm. You don't normally get that.
I forgot about that ending. Oh, great.
He's a character, huh?
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
I haven't gone back and listened to any Jackyl probably ever since the original period of time that it was spun frequently in the house. I don't think I've ever gone back and listened to the Jackyl.
I've gone and checked out some of their stuff, and it's always high energy, entertaining stuff. I mean, I haven't bought any albums or anything, but have nothing bad to say about the band.
No.
Yeah. I mean, I would recommend going. Find it's on the Cut the Crap album. It's the track 2, the Locked and Loaded with Brian Johnson on the dual vocal. Doesn't get any better than that, as far as I'm concerned. I'm talking about Jackyl, to even get him to guest on your album is a feat unto itself.
That's
but the
true.
Two of them together, caterwauling into the mic, going back and forth. If you never heard it, do yourself a favor, go listen to it.
Yeah, I've not heard it.
So I know I'd read this before and I wanted to share it. Jackyl has set 2 Guinness World Records.
I saw that, yeah. Go.
One for playing 100 concerts in 50 days and one for performing 21 concerts in a 24-hour period.
How do you do that?
You got me.
What kind of...
I'm playing fast and loose with the definition of the word concert, but who knows?
I mean, I don't know if it means it had to be a different venue every time.
Maybe you would think. Otherwise, you'd just be like, we're going to play a 45-minute set. We're done. That's a concert.
Yeah. Who knows?
Bring in another crowd or something. Who knows how they ran that?
I'm guessing it was on the back of a flatbed or something.
That could have been it.
Every stoplight counts as a concert. I don't know how else they could have pulled that off. You said 21 concerts in 24 hours.
Yep.
Well, I guess you know what that means. We have to do 22.
Oh, man.
Get the band back together.
So and they have done some interesting covers, and I was trying to find some in particular.
Mm-hmm.
On their 2012 album, Best in Show, they covered It's Tricky by Run-DMC.
Hmm.
That's got to be good.
Cover of the Rolling Stone by Dr. Hook and the Medicine Show.
Yep.
and we will rock you. Oh no, just sampled it. But yeah, and I had seen some other ones on some of their some of the albums. Some pretty cool. Can't find it right now, but there was like an old soul song or something like that, I think, that they did that was pretty cool. Oh, you know what I think it was?
Did he guest on Soul Station?
No, you know what I think it was? It was a song that we did. We covered here. It was Everyone's a Winner.
Oh, that works.
By Hot Chocolate. I'm pretty sure they did that too.
That works for Jack.
I can't find it, what album it's on, but yeah. Interesting band. I'm gonna have to check them out. I thoroughly enjoyed this song. There's no question.
What does that mean, Nick?
That means call up Joe Lynn Turner. Have him sing it.
It's Sweet Surrender.
Hell yes.
Yeah, it's just... I loved it back then, and it's preposterous.
It is.
But it's pulled off.
Yeah.
Like the... Evan? I'm sorry. Evan submitted this, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Evan said he compared it to sax being used in rock and roll.
Yeah.
Right.
It's absolutely true. It's not just like, oh, it's silly and that's it. It absolutely works. It's again, preposterous, but 100% great effect, great execution, great energy. I mean, musically, it's just, it's that basic sort of
bump, bump, bump.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that it's 12 bar blues exactly. I wasn't really listening that closely, trying to analyze it, but it's more or less, you know, just like basic hard rock blues riff. And
well, you don't want anything else to get in the way, though. Right?
Well, that's true. That's true, because you're showcasing something completely outlandish. So yeah, so you don't want to clutter up the arrangement.
No.
But, nothing bad to say about it. Thoroughly entertaining. And isn't that why you listen to music most of the time?
Good point. All right. I'll vote next. I'm giving it a Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender.
Hell yes.
So much to say. First thing I'm wondering, and I'm sure Jackyl fans know this, or if you just look it up, but how do you think he got to the point where he's like running a chainsaw for that long and experimenting with notes?
Man, who knows? Yeah.
Like, this was his career before music? Was he just like a maniac who would fire up a chainsaw in the backyard and...
You know, I don't
know.
You
wonder, right?
I don't know, but yeah.
Because you don't just think of that like, oh, I know what I can do. I can make a chainsaw, make different notes, and play it on top of music. I feel like that had to be.
Yeah, and really, you know.
From hours.
You're limited to how many notes? I don't know, two?
I
many?
Three.
No, yeah, maybe.
I don't know.
That was when he was using his Mongolian chainsaw.
Dual blade.
Two notes at the same time.
Yeah. And then, just thinking, does it make a different note when you're cutting into wood? Versus no wood?
I would assume so.
I would think so. It slows the blade down a bit.
Yeah.
And, you know.
Different wood species make a different... Who knows? There's a lot going on.
Very nuanced musical instrument.
Yeah, it is. Another Jackyl story I thought of while we were listening to that. Nick, do you remember when Tom Green had that talk show on MTV for like a summer?
I do.
It was after the Tom Green show. It was on MTV, but it was a...
Yeah.
It's supposed to be like
that's kind of still what he does, right?
I think so. I don't know if he still does that, but he does that home.
Yeah, just more of a talk show.
Yeah, but that was like, I don't know, maybe 02 or 03 or something. He was doing this show, and one of the guests was Jesse James Dupree. He came out and sawed his desk, not in half, but like a huge chunk of the desk off the corner, and the whole... thing. He was just, Tom Green was pissed that Jesse James Dupree saw at his desk, and he's like, I know, it's
let's
like,
face it,
you know what you're getting.
You got Jesse James Dupree,
but it was like he was upset because I forgot exactly what it was, but it was like, we had this desk made to be an exact replica of Johnny Carson's original desk, and we spent whatever, like $30,000 on it, and there's, you know, that's like all of our budget. And then he cut the desk.
Well, whoever was booking that show,
that's on them. You got to know what you're
getting
into.
Hey, Jesse James Dupree.
You got to know what you're getting into.
Exactly.
Bring out the IKEA desk when you book him that day. Put the
do we want
antique replica or whatever away.
Plus, well, I mean, that's a cool little tidbit, but probably nobody noticed that it looked like Johnny Carson.
Exactly.
Yeah,
it was completely lost on everybody.
A terrible appropriation of your budget.
Yeah.
It's just a terrible move.
And yeah.
What happened probably should have happened.
Yeah.
So.
Can't disagree. Chris?
Oh, Sweet Surrender for me, yeah.
It's Sweet Surrender.
I mean, the guy's basically built a career off of this shtick.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And as we've talked about, there's other stuff in the catalog that, for what it is high quality. You know, the members of learned societies are probably not going to think it's, you know, intellectual enough for them. But, yeah, for what it is, it's high quality, but... Would they even be on anybody's radar without this shtick? I mean, this shtick is just, it gives them an edge over other similar bands, yeah. I think. And just the way he is and his voice and just, you know, you can't just fabricate that. I mean, I suppose you could, but he's genuine about it and, you know, pioneered rock and roll chainsaw playing, and you got to give him credit for that.
Yep. Well, look where we are, guys.
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
Paul Stanley.
What was he thinking?
He's befuddled again, to use that word twice in one show. What the hell's going on out there? Should we hang it up?
Is this something that I need to learn how to do?
He needs to know if the Lumberjack is a rock and roll boner classic as voted by the three rock and roll boners in this room.
My vote's in.
Nick's vote is in. Nick's vote is in.
And I'll go first, too.
Okay. Chris, what do you got?
My vote's in.
Andy, have you ever sung along with an appliance?
I've tried to match the note of an appliance before.
Yeah, have you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, match a note maybe. Try to see if you can do a third or a fifth or something
along
with it.
I've done that with like a vacuum or a dust buster.
Yeah, I've done that.
Yep.
It's fun.
Yep. Never a chainsaw.
No, I've never handled a chainsaw.
I bought one a few years ago, but I bought like the worst one that they made, the cheapest one they made, and it's a plug-in electric one, just to cut some branches off in the yard.
I mean, I had one, did the trick. My ex-brother-in-law destroyed it, cutting back
in
brush.
In his Jackyl cover band?
No, cutting back brush at one of his slumlord properties and just wrecked it and then brought it back and didn't say anything, and I tried to use it again and it just was
chain flew, just fucking, flew across the street.
You know. and when he brought it back, the it was a Craftsman. So the logo on the blade was upside down. So I could see right away that he had removed the blade and replaced it upside down.
Yeah, he had some trouble.
And that's when I knew trouble, you know, speaking of trouble, I was like, okay, something's going to be wrong with this, and it just wouldn't even fire up, and I mean, I'm still pissed about that to this day, but whatever, he's my ex-brother-in-law now, not for that reason, but could have been for that reason, but yeah, I've never, maybe once or twice back in my Parks and Rec days, I might have fired up a real chainsaw, but the real one is next level.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like, makes you feel like a man. I imagine it's similar to firing a powerful pistol or a rifle or something. Just that visceral manliness that comes out of you when you're operating such a dangerous piece of equipment.
Yeah.
It's really, its only purpose is to destroy something.
Yeah.
You gotta respect that, you know?
Yeah.
Guns, chainsaws. There's no altruistic capability in any of those things. So
no.
So you gotta respect that, and it does tap into your primal instincts and pleasure centers, and that, you know.
And that's...
I'm sure that wasn't lost on anybody when this shtick was created, adding it to music. Be yeah. similar to, you know, trying to get, you know, fluctuating musical notes from a semi-automatic rifle, you know, adjusting the pitch as you're, you know, adjusting the pitch of the thing as you're, you know, unleashing, emptying a magazine of rounds. Now, that would be a tough thing to record in a recording studio, but... Chainsaw is the next best thing, similar to piece of equipment. It's not like an edger or something like that, you know. It's definitely more, makes you feel like a man when you use it.
Well, what if you use it to carve, to make art? Like those people who do like a Kodiak bear out of
a tree
stump.
I saw a guy doing that last month.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I guess there is a creative element to, well, in creating music, of course, but just to have that power in your hands and the sound, and if you're doing a wood carving, you're still destroying, taking apart, dismantling log as it was when you started. So
that's true.
I think you get the same joy.
Hey, Nick, where did you see this happening?
It was in an alley.
Where are you hanging out?
In Brown County.
Okay, it was like a...
It was a tourist thing.
It's like an exhibit or whatever,
well, it was just in an alley, though, the guy was doing it.
But not four people
and
to
I'm
watch?
Like, hey, let's go down there. Well, we kind of stood there and watched for a second.
But it wasn't like in the town square where everyone's selling his stuff.
I think he was selling it, but he must have just been producing the stuff in the back alley.
Wow, okay. Was he good?
Yeah, look good.
Yeah. My neighbor's got a totem pole in their yard.
Yeah, I noticed.
Yeah.
I never knew that. What's up with that?
I don't know. It's
the actual Native Americans or no?
No. Guy's French Canadian.
So what's the deal with that?
I honestly don't know. It's been like that long before I lived there, but you could tell it was a tree that probably died or got struck by lightning or something. And
he
then,
turned it into a totem.
Yeah. So it's like an owl or a hawk or I can't tell what the bird is. Some kind of bird face, a bear, and I forgot what the third thing is. But it's like three faces. The top one's the bird with the wings sticking out.
It's a landmark.
Yeah.
It's kind of like heading south on 41. You see that one front yard that's got part of the McDonald Playland in the front yard.
You wonder how that happened. Like the cheeseburger with the jail bars
yes,
or whatever?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. How do they get that?
And why is it in the front?
Yeah.
But I love it anyway.
And is it for sale?
Yeah.
See, if I had a totem pole in my backyard and somebody asked me about it, I'd be like, "Yeah, that's not important. So what do you got in your backyard?"
Yeah.
You
know? Yeah, yeah.
Keep the mystique about it. That's what the same approach to your learned society is.
Yeah, just talk it down as unremarkable.
There you go.
It's old hat. No big deal.
That old thing. All right. Nick, Chris, Andy, I guess.
Okay. Rock.
Roll.
Boom.
Now, would you at all be surprised if you learned that Jesse James Dupree and the PBA tour combined forces at some point,
made in
and he was like sawing pins, you know, the tops of the pins off, and
somebody at the PBA needs to make this happen. I mean, that's a marketing slam dunk right there.
They could have a line of bowling balls based on song titles.
Yeah,
you know, there's like the Rhino Pro and the classics. You know,
mm-hmm.
The Lumberjack works fine. Yeah, you could do that.
Yep, Locked and Loaded would be a good one. Yeah, I mean, you get the chainsaw out. When sawing up pins, destroying entire alleys, you could do that.
When you leave one pin, the I Stand Alone starts playing over the loudspeakers.
That works. That's good. Yeah, all right. Well,
yeah, so anyway, that was great.
Yeah.
What a great song.
Yeah, it's hard to deny that one.
Yeah, I mean, you could say what you want, but they really, really are convincing and seemed sincere in the whole shtick, the whole presentation.
Oh yeah. And that you don't get the sense.
And that's something where you can criticize it, you know, downplay it, but it does, it's like one of those things where it just doesn't matter because you get the feeling they don't care. It's kind of like if you criticize Ted Nugent,
mm-hmm.
it's clear that he loves it, and it's going to discourage him 0%.
All it's going to do is it's going to solidify that he made the right choice with the way he's behaved for the last 50 years.
Ultimately.
Yeah.
There's no apology.
No. And you have to respect that too in some way.
In something like this, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, if you disagree with us, we're sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Nick, you know what time it is, don't you?
Oh, I hope it's the commercial.
It is. It's time for a commercial. All right. Your favorite. What'd you think?
Best ribs in town at that place.
I'll have to try it for lunch tomorrow. All right, but until then.
I don't get yards of questions.
Motherfucker, I give them.
Swing away.
Yes.
Speaking of chainsaws.
I was going to say, the Lawrence Taylor sawing Jamie Foxx's car in half in Any Given Sunday. One of the most ridiculous scenes in all of cinema and cinematic history.
And like this song, unapologetically preposterous.
Yeah, it's just completely ridiculous.
And that's probably its greatest strength.
Of course. Yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah. The fun you can have with a chainsaw.
I guess.
I didn't realize that a vehicle was sawed in half.
Yes. Have you seen the movie?
No.
Okay, yeah, you need to see it. We all need to watch it together.
I don't think I've seen it since it was in... Since it was in cinemas.
Yeah, I haven't seen it in a while now, so I'm ready for another viewing. It's worth it. Absolutely. That, again, in Devil's Advocate, every scene is so over the top, ridiculous. It's just unrelenting from start to finish.
Huh. Do we have to?
Yes.
Okay.
Are you not finding anything you like?
I'm going with this one. I didn't even read it. Here we go. All right,
that's sometimes the best way.
But, yeah. Why not close out Pot of Thunder Month with a little danger? Since we're talking about a dangerous piece of equipment in the chainsaw, it fits.
Yeah, it looks, without reading it, it just looks like it's formatted correctly. So,
well, it's like a resume.
For that.
Yeah, exactly. All right, this week's Yardo Questions comes to us from Jim Thompson. What's up, Jim?
What you got, Jim?
He's got some. I accidentally just submitted a deuce of questions. So here's the final product. Hopefully, you'll get it. You'll get it before this website's Mindspring domain expires. What does that mean?
I don't know.
Reference.
Sounds like a threat to me.
Early internet. Who knows?
Okay. Sorry. I don't know that one. Is he saying that our form is not good? It's a Google.
I mean, it
form.
Works.
I mean, it works.
I think you might be talking about the visuals of the website.
Okay.
It's not exactly cutting edge, but, you know, it works.
There you go.
Case in point, all the visits we've been getting from Sweden and Australia. So.
Mm-hmm. I can't get enough. They just keep reloading it, waiting for more content.
They do.
Question one. Have you ever seen a live show that made you a fan of a band or artist that you previously didn't care all that much for? For example, I always thought Springsteen's music was just okay until I saw him live. The energy was so incredible that I wouldn't miss another show within 100 miles of me.
I've got one. And I think it fits the criteria that he laid down. It's not that I went out and bought albums by this band or have followed them really since, but as a live act, I thought that was really good. Like, as a band I didn't care about at all, and that's Soul Asylum.
Oh.
Didn't care. Heard their hits, whatever. Knew the guy, the singer was like a tabloid celebrity with Winona Ryder.
I didn't even realize that.
And stuff like that. But
they were an item?
Yeah, I remember that at least. But saw them, I want to say it was 96 at a Rock 103.5 or Blaze 103.5 at that point. I don't know.
Right.
It was at Alpine Valley. A whole lot of bands played. But Soul Asylum was one of them. And I was like, all right, I'll just sit through Soul Asylum. Really impressed with the live performance. Really good live band. Even though like it wasn't huge on the material.
Yeah.
But was very impressed. So
okay.
Not that I went to become a diehard fan that consumed everything they put out, but I did become a fan in a sense of theirs, based on that performance.
They earned your respect.
Yeah.
Which isn't easy to do. You're talking about Nick Jones. Me?
You?
Well, I've mentioned it several times before, but it fits here. I like harder rock music, harder rock styles. I wouldn't say I'm a metalhead, though. Like, full-on metal is just... I like the conviction, the aggression, but I don't necessarily, like, put it on to listen to just for enjoyment. You know, I prefer more, like... just hard rock, classic rock, stuff based like that. But the two times I saw Slayer are easily two of the best concerts I've ever seen in my life. I would say probably two of the top five, possibly two of the top three.
Hmm.
Just incredible live energy and just everything about them in a live setting, the presentation, amazing, and just the execution of the music. And you know, I saw them in 88 with the original lineup, and then I saw them on their final tour, I believe, with Bostaff and Gary Holt and replacing Hanneman and Lombardo, and both shows were absolutely outstanding.
All right. Question two. Was JFK killed by Oswald, or was it a conspiracy?
He was killed by Oswald.
There you go. Open and shut case.
Yeah.
But Oswald was put up to it, I think.
Yeah?
I think so.
As we know, that Jack Ruby wanted 5 minutes alone with him, and he ended up getting it and put a bullet in him. But actually, he didn't get 5 minutes alone. It happened right in front of everybody.
Yeah,
but,
how wild is that? That happened. That, and then Bobby Kennedy a few years later killed on TV.
Yeah,
what's going on?
Surprised it hasn't happened very, very often since.
I guess security measures of. I would assume.
Oh, that guy in China, or was it Japan recently?
Yeah, that's true.
Taken down by that homemade gun or something. That's pretty hardcore stuff. But I don't know. I just take it at face value all the conspiracy theory stuff around the Kennedy assassination. I never really delved into it. Mm-hmm. You, Andy?
No. I don't, unless you really want to dedicate a huge portion of your life.
I was going to say, I just don't have the time or the energy for it.
Yeah. Because otherwise you're just convincing yourself this or that based on however you feel or however you want to feel. Like, do you want to be the guy who's like, I know something that other people don't know? Because I feel like that's the majority of conspiracy theory people. That's like, what it's rooted in.
Like someone who collects Kiss videos?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, right.
It's like you want to know the secret, or at least act like, well, you people, you commoners believe this, but what really happened? Yeah, and then you believe everyone because that's how your mind works.
Yeah. No, you're right.
Yeah. And I think, honestly, it's one of those things we'll never know. It's like Area 51. We'll never know.
And how much did it really change the course of history afterwards, whether he acted alone or it was a conspiracy? Did it really change things that much?
Like, what did him getting killed change things, or
I mean, just
or how he got killed?
How it happened? Yeah, I don't. You know, if it was a you know, concerted conspiracy, what was the end game, and did it ever play out? I mean, society is still plugging along 60 years later.
I mean, I would say, just based, and I haven't read up on it that much, but like here and there a little bit.
Yeah.
I would say the most plausible explanation is organized crime, because the Kennedys were going after some people in organized crime, especially, don't they say Bobby Kennedy was?
Yeah.
Even more so.
Yeah.
So that to me is the most plausible, just from the from the remedial amount of stuff that I've read about it, that they were just, you know, they made certain people upset.
Right, but again, organized crime still in effect. I mean, does it really affect people who don't, you know, trifle with them, so to speak? I mean, are our lives different because organized crime is still out there? I mean, I don't know.
I
don't know what the big deal is. Why would you get all bent out of shape and want to find the truth about something? It's like, it happened. Get on with
and
your life.
And frankly, you'll never know.
You'll never know, so why are you wasting your life?
If the FBI or CIA or whoever, say they've got some documents and they release them, here's exactly what happened.
Yeah.
What are the chances that people are going to say, oh, okay.
Yeah, they're
like, not. I totally believe it.
Yeah.
They're not.
I'll accept that as fact.
That ship is absolutely sailed.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what, like with the current thing with the Mar-a-Lago documents, like it doesn't matter if they black out stuff or if they release the whole document. You're going to believe what you want to believe. It doesn't. That's the times we live in. It's like, you know,
everyone's playing fan fiction in their minds.
Well, and everybody's suspicious.
Yeah. But yeah, and you also, you know, we also live in an era where everybody's carrying a video camera on them and their phone.
Mm-hmm.
All the cops are wearing body cams. So you're seeing video of every incident that happens. You still, it's right there in black and white, and you still have people like, nah, that's not what's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you're never going to get any kind of consensus. That ship has sailed.
Yep. All right. Question 3.
Oh, I thought he only had 2.
Well, he submitted this one time with 2 and then resubmitted it with 3. He made a boo-boo. He pressed submit too soon.
You got to admire him for going back and
getting it right. Get it right.
Yep. Question 3, had John Lennon lived,
oh boy,
how bad would the Beatles reunion have been in the 80s on a scale of the Jacksons to Simon and Garfunkel? All 80s reunions were underwhelming.
Oh, gosh.
Where would this have fallen?
Here we go. It would have been really shitty because you know Jeff Lynne would have horned his way into it somehow. Mm. And that is an absolute fact. He would have somehow ended up producing them with his shitty sound. and probably wormed his way into being a player on stage at some point, and it would have ruined the whole thing. It would have been god fucking awful for that reason.
There you go. Real bad. Chris says
real
no.
bad.
He brought up the Jacksons. I was remembering the song Torture, which I believe was one of their 80s singles. Absolutely terrible.
That's without Michael, right?
I think
Michael was involved.
I think he was involved, but it wasn't good.
No, he was minimal more of a figurehead involved.
Yeah, there was a video where it was like just a shadow of him, and then the other
Victory tour. That was it, right? Yeah, Jackyl was involved. I mean, he participated. Yeah. In terms of his actual involvement.
I mean, that was post-Thriller, so...
So any ticket they sold was based on...
Michael Jackson's gonna be there.
It was a mistake.
For him?
Yeah.
He's probably obligated.
Yeah, I guess.
That reminds me of a Karnak joke.
Okay.
Where he said, Hasbro, or however you pronounce that, and it was, how does Tito Jackson still get work? Yeah. Old Johnny Carson, yeah. Karnak, some of that stuff was incredible.
Yeah.
But to get to the actual substance here, they probably would have, and... I have a feeling it would have been sort of like when the Police got back together 15 years ago, where there really wouldn't have been much collaborative creative output from it, new creative output. Probably just a very successful tour, or maybe just a few really huge shows, if I had to guess. It probably would have been momentous. Just for the fact of what it was.
Well, it definitely would have been momentous. But it would have been good. No, because Jeff Lynne would have been involved.
I do think, and I think we've talked about this on the podcast before, though, I think if John Lennon had lived, he'd be a political talking head on, like, CNN or something right now.
That's all we need.
I mean, he would have been, you know, like a radio... He would have had a radio show, nationally syndicated... And probably would be transitioning into like a Larry King, but maybe even more political sort of a figure at this point.
Yeah.
My guess.
Be interesting.
Which he probably would have been good at.
Yeah.
But if you don't want to think of John Lennon as being a host of a show like that.
Yeah.
Then it could probably make you a little queasy to think about. But let's face it, that's probably where he would have gone. He was because he was always so involved.
He never kept his mouth shut about politics.
Yeah, yeah. Essentially,
at least you know from about 68 on, just you know, Mr. Peacenik and all his other bullshit he got involved in.
And he was a man of extremes too. So I would imagine would have amassed so much experience of all that. He would have fallen somewhere into a more moderate. Middle ground.
Yeah, I'm guessing. I don't know about that.
Wasn't that kind of how he was at the end of his life, though? I don't know.
Like,
I don't know about John Lennon.
Less extreme and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, like, I would have to go back and look at it. I just remember reading some stuff 20 years ago, and I can't remember, but that, like, later in his life, he was kind of like, I don't know if he was more, like, angry at the movement he was formerly a part of. Like, the peace... like the hippie movement for like not ever doing anything and just being like a fashion thing, and so he was more like pissed off.
So basically the song Revolution came true on him.
Yeah.
I heard something interesting about Double Fantasy. It had come out right before he got killed. Pretty close to it.
Yeah.
And I had read somewhere that there were publications who had basically in the can, they had negative reviews. They were going to chide it. He gets killed. They can't release that.
Change it.
And it becomes album of the year.
Wow.
And it's not a great album, in my opinion. I tried listening to it all the way through. It's fine in some parts. Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous in some parts.
I've never heard it,
but
yeah, I've never
it's not album of the year material, in my opinion.
Like, did it win a Grammy? Is that what
you mean? I think it won a Grammy for album of the year. Yeah,
it just shows you how little credibility that sort of thing has. It's so stupid.
Yeah. But I found that fascinating that they were ready to rail it, and they're like,
can't do it now. Be bad taste.
Yeah, and I guess in a way it would have been.
It would have been.
It would have been hard for people to separate it, because, yeah.
Yeah, now you know it would be like the complete opposite. They'd be so happy to put it out.
Yeah.
We're glad he died. This album sucks.
Yeah, I was about to say that sort of decorum never entered the minds of critics before. But John Lennon, the Beatle, the ultimate sacred cow. I guess they just couldn't do it in his case. But
yeah. As Stephen Banks said, John Lennon was the Beatle that bled.
And who is Stephen Banks?
That was just a reference for Andy. He had an HBO special that we watched over and over and over in the 80s.
Yep. I don't remember the line, though.
What does that mean, though? I mean, I know what it means, but what context?
He was performing a song about various rock stars who had passed on and how they passed on.
Was somebody playing the drums?
That was at the end.
Okay.
That was the big celebratory scene.
There you go. HBO special from the probably late 80s. All right. Well, hey, it's the last week. Pot of Thunder month.
Get out of here.
Next month it's September. But one more time. Let's do it. Everybody, get ready. This is it until the next Pot of Thunder month.